Hey guys, it's Kat from the Motorhome Travel website, Wandering Bird. Today I'm going to answer some questions I've been getting about off-grid power, especially when we're wild camping. And to do that, I brought along the expert in all things technical in our van, Mr. Wandering Bird.
Morning, evening, afternoon.
Yes. Hello, wherever you are, whatever you're doing, hi. We're going to get into all that very quickly. Thank you for all of you who've been putting in your questions. Before we get started answering that, if you'd like to see more videos about technical aspects of motorhome travel, the dog is like, how do I get into the camera shot? If you want to see more about motorhome travel or traveling around the UK and Europe, then be sure to subscribe to this channel. And if you want to get information sent straight to your inbox, then sign up to our mailing list and I'll send you all the fun stuff as it happens. Sorry if the camera's moving, a certain dog is jumping around like a crazy idiot. Right, let's get into off-grid power, how it works. So I'm going to go back to the very, very, very beginning basics because I don't really understand a lot about power anyway, which is why I brought the expert. So I'll explain it to you in very easy terms to start off with. You basically have two ways of getting power inside your motorhome. You've got the 240 volts, so when you're plugged in using your little lead, technical term.
Power lead.
Thank you. I said lead. Yeah. To get power.
I'll go with it.
Uh-huh. So if you're plugged into a campsite or at home and your van is connected to an external power source, you're going to have 240 volts. So you can use normal plugs like you do at home, and you can use things like electric kettles and hair dryers and microwaves and all of this stuff. We'll get to generators in a little bit, but you can also get 240 volts off a genset. If your van is not connected with a power lead to an external power source, you do not have 240 volts, which means you can't use your normal plugs. He's going to interrupt
me.
We're talking very basic and we're going to get to the unless. Okay, so normally you're only running off your battery, which is 12 volts, so your normal UK 3-pin plugs will not work. There is an unless. We're going to work up to that. So, assuming that you're off-grid and therefore you're not going to be plugged into anything, you can only use your 12 volt sockets, which are normally the little round cigarette lightery type things that give you power. So if you have, I'm gonna let him loose in a minute, let me just work through these steps in my head.
I'm braced.
If you have an electric kettle that only works off a 3-pin normal UK plug, it's not going to work if you're not on proper electrical mained power. Thank you, that was what I wanted. Which means a gas kettle is a really good idea, by the way, just as an aside. It also means your very expensive, lovely, posh hairdryer won't work. And no, I have not found a decent 12-volt hairdryer yet, although I've tried many.
We have tried many.
So, that is the first thing to understand. It's that no matter how many batteries you put in your van, or solar panels, or anything else, you're not going to be able to use your 3-pin, 240-volt plugs if you're not plugged in. Okay, let's get to the buts. How do we get power whilst we're not plugged in?
I'm just going to add something about your 12-volt hairdryer, because we have used a lot, and whilst I remember, most 12-volt hairdryers are 6 or 10 amp. They're ridiculously power hungry.
If your brain's exploding right now, just bear with it. So we're going to explain that in a minute.
Basically, they use a lot of power, which means that the 12-volt sockets in the back of the van that you normally get around the habitation area, actually, you'll blow the fuses if you use them. They will only work on the big, heavy-duty cigarette lighter socket in the front cab, which means normally you've got to have your engine running to use them.
So how do you know? Is there a way? So we've got cigarette sockets at the back of the van and at the front in the cab.
We have.
How do we know which one I could plug a 12-volt hairdryer into?
On these at the back, they all say 3 amp or 6 amp.
What, on the actual sockets on the outside?
Themselves. And I've the ones at the back I've wired in because the van didn't have enough.
We're going to get to that because somebody's been asking about our van. We'll do that in another
The ones I've wired in, we've wired at 6 amps.
Yeah.
The van had 1 6 amp and 1 3 amp as standard. So we had to put extra. But your 12 volt, the only one that was vaguely kind of okay-ish is 10 amp.
So not only do you have to look to make sure that it's a 12 volt hairdryer or appliance, because this applies to many things, you also then have to look at the ampage when you buy it.
Yes, you do, just based on where you're plugging it into. The problem you've got is you don't really have much choice. To generate heat, it needs power.
Yeah.
And to get power, it takes amps.
But this also applies to all sorts of things, like what sort of ampage is an electric toothbrush? or a shaver.
Minuscule things. They're tiny.
Okay, so those sorts of things you don't...
Yeah.
You should still check the ampage based on your...
An electric toothbrush, because all it's doing, you're not running the electric toothbrush, you're recharging the battery.
That's true.
But it's taking the same as charging your phone.
Yes. So not all phones and things are fine on pretty much all cigarette sockets, aren't they?
Yeah, so simple things. iPhone 5, 6 and 7s are 1 amp charging, which means that your little 12 volt charger sockets you can buy, they normally have two plugs in there, 1 amp each, they're fine. Mm-hmm. What a lot of people do, they'll buy these 12 volt cigarette charger sockets and say, but it doesn't work on my iPad. That's because your iPad needs 2 to 3 amps to charge.
Yes, we had that problem, didn't we?
And iPhone 10s need 2 amps to charge, 2.1 amps. So you've got to be careful. If you've got a 3 amp cigarette light socket and you put a 3-way 12 volt charger in there and you put your phone or two phones and an iPad in, mm-hmm. and you've got one iPhone 6 or one iPhone 7, an iPhone 10 and a reasonable size iPad, so the 12-inch iPad, you're going to blow it.
I'm going to rephrase that. If you have a 3 amp socket and you've put a multi-way charging thing, so you've got all these different leads coming out,
and that is
and
more
you've
than
got
3 amps.
2 amps on an iPad, 2 amps on an iPhone X, did you say, and 2 amps on something else, that's 6 amps. Even if you just had 2 of them in, that's 4 amps, which is more than the 3 amp socket.
You'll blow the fuse.
So it'll blow. Okay, that makes sense. That makes sense.
The good thing is, if the van is wired correctly, you should only blow the fuse, and then normally spade fuse.
And can you just take out the appropriate fuse and you can't put a big one in?
Oh dear, no.
See, this is the sort of question that I'd ask. So,
this is what happens when you see motorhomes or cars in flames at the side of the road.
Okay.
Because people say, oh, well, what I'll do is I'll change that 5-amp fuse and I'll put a 10-amp fuse in, and it works great for 20 minutes whilst the wiring is getting hotter and hotter.
So it's down to the size of the wiring. I remember this when we did the boat remodels.
It's exactly down to the size of the wire.
So I think we've covered that. That's cool. So we're good on 12 volts, I think. And the 12 volts come from your battery. Which leads me to the whole other question that I got asked. So I'll roll it all into one. You will generally have at least 2 batteries on your motorhome. You're going to have the engine battery, and you're going to have a leisure battery. Some vans have 2 leisure batteries, but most as standard just have 1. When you are going...
Driving.
Engine going. Running. When the engine's running.
Do you drive like that?
That's how I drive.
Is that how you drive?
Have you seen the video of how I drive? It's like that. Oh, gear change. Like this. When we're going, most of the power of the van, even the 12-volt sockets on the front where you're charging, is coming from the engine battery, am I right?
Yes, it's coming from the engine battery and the alternator.
Cool. So the leisure battery isn't doing hardly anything when we're driving, when the engine's
charging.
Running.
So the...
Okay, go on, explain that.
The leisure battery normally is charging whilst the engine's running. The alternator in the car, which is like the car's version of a dynamo, it generates electricity based on the car, the engine moving.
Yeah.
And that recharges your... engine battery, your leisure battery, and it will run certain items. So it will run lights, it will run things like that.
Okay.
If it's a big enough alternator.
But when the engine is running, the leisure battery is literally just being recharged.
Normally, yes.
Yeah.
Unless, and there's a couple of unlesses on this one. So we have the Truma heating system that allows you to use the heating while you're driving.
Mm-hmm.
It uses the leisure battery for the heating.
Okay.
We have certain sockets.
So if we drive a long way...
That are live drive.
With that on, the leisure battery won't actually get that charged, will it?
It will, depends on how cold it is and how high we've got it. But there's only so much. They normally charge at anything, you know, from 4 amps to 25 amps. So if you think about it, if your heating system's taking 10 amps and it's night and your windscreen wipers are on and you've got the front heating on, you've got a 75-amp alternator.
Mm-hmm.
Your lights might be taking 5 amps. Your heating might be taking 10 amps. Mm-hmm. Your back heating is taking 10 amps.
Mm-hmm.
At some point, you end up with only a couple of amps left to charge the batteries.
Yeah.
So.
And is that how it works? So what the vehicle needs comes out of that 75 amps, for example, and then whatever's left goes into recharging the batteries?
Essentially, yes. So you've seen me do it many times. If we've run the battery low or I need to charge it,
mm-hmm.
I'll turn the lights off if we're driving during the day.
Not during the night.
Or I'll turn heating off. Air conditioning,
off.
They all run off pulleys. But they also drain two things, fuel consumption and power out of the battery.
Okay, well, we'll focus mainly on power for today. So, the next question then came from, what happens if you're not going to be driving? So we tend to do a lot of driving, which we've always said if we do one day stopped, then the next day we'll charge the batteries. How long do you reckon from a day at rest, so we haven't been driving but we've been using a lot of things and the battery is fairly run down, how do you know if the battery is too run down?
Well, we have a monitor so we can see it. And
do we?
Monitor is an intelligent battery management system, and what it does is it stops us from using the battery if it gets too low. If you deplete your battery below 50%, the chances are you've broken your battery completely.
Okay.
And need a new one. Getting it to come back from that and be acceptable is very, very
difficult.
Is that
a standard for all batteries or just our specific make of battery?
Lead acid. Now, to be fair, the leisure battery actually is, I think we've got an AGM battery, which is a dry battery. It's a very, one of the new technologies. I'll get into battery technologies separately because you've got all sorts. You've got lithium ion, you've got lead acid.
Yeah. We're doing a general overview.
Yeah. And the cost varies as well.
Yeah.
Can I get it to a cardboard collection? There we go. Yeah.
So we can see the leisure battery is good.
Now that 13.0 is what we're getting.
That's the volts.
From the solar panel, yeah?
Yeah, so it's charging quite well.
We're plugged into mains at the moment, aren't we?
So we can see the amps that are kicking in, there's no amps being taken from it.
Yeah.
That's because it's fully charged.
Okay.
Normally that would tell us how many amps we've got. We can see the voltage that it's charging at.
Yeah. And that's how you see what we're getting from...
Yeah, so that's the leisure battery.
So when we're not plugged in and we're using stuff, can it show what we're draining?
Yes, it will show what
it will
draining.
Show. Okay.
So that amp there... Yeah. If it's in the positive side, it's topping up the battery. If it's in the negative side, it's what we're taking out of the battery.
Draining.
So we can see we're charging it. See how it's fluctuating all the time?
Yeah, that's from the solar panel, isn't
it? Yeah, it's just... Okay. You can see we're getting 1 amp. 1.2. Yeah. So it's shifting around.
Okay.
On average, we'll probably get 3 or 4 amps an hour.
Okay. All right. Awesome.
But we've got it to... solar to vehicle.
What's the 14.5 that was just on?
That's what's feeding to the engine battery. We're topping up both the leisure battery and the engine battery from the solar panel at the moment.
So the leisure battery is at 13-something and the vehicle battery is at 14.5?
That's only because we've got power going into it. So a 12-volt battery should sit at 12.1 volts.
Okay.
If you start getting below 12.1 volts, your battery can need a charge.
So, I can't remember exactly what we were talking about.
So essentially, if you've got a 75-amp alternator on your car, or on your motorhome, and you have a 100-amp battery, let's make the figures easy, 100-amp leisure battery, you deplete that, so you're at the 50% point. You take it to the bare minimum.
And when you get to the 50% point, your system or your battery monitor will beep and say...
Shuts down.
You've got to stop.
On ours, it does. It depends. I mean, if you just wired it direct... It won't.
Okay.
So at that point, you're 50 amps down. I'm using basic figures.
Yeah. No,
anyone
that's good
with a calculator and an understanding of electrics.
We're kind of assuming that anyone who understands this probably isn't watching the video, and that it's people like me who don't really understand this who are watching this, and we want to use basic terms.
You've got 50 amps left.
Yes.
Okay, that you need to replenish.
Yes.
You've got a 75-amp alternator.
Yes.
Okay, that alternator...
And that's 75 an hour, isn't it? That's what that means.
75 amp hour.
Yes.
So it's amps per hour. Yep. But that uses everything, so it recharges your engine battery and everything else. So it allocates about 25 amps to recharge your leisure battery. So technically, 2 hours it should be, you would say, 25 amps an hour.
Yes.
The reality is... You're charging phones, you're doing other things.
So it's probably going to be less.
It will go more and more and more.
So the basic rule of thumb is that, can you deplete it to 50% in a day? How long would it take?
It depends what you're using. So if you're...
Generally in our life, how long does it take?
Most motorhomes, we can get 2 days of solid usage without depleting it. We can actually get 3 days, but that's on the basis we don't have lights on during the day. All our lights are LED, so they're very low.
Yeah.
Now. We use 1 amp if we've got every
But we've changed on. A lot of systems or changed a lot of... Made sure that the setup we've got is to be as economical on this as possible so we yeah. can stay off grid for yeah. two, three,
so we've,
4 days.
You know, we did... In our previous van, we had two big ledger batteries plus yeah. a big engine battery.
Yeah.
In this one, we've only got one. We've not needed a second one.
So we're going to get to that, because yeah. that was a question I got asked. So let's just continue this through. So let's say it's taken us 2 days to go down to 50%, and the system is now saying, you're at your limit, you've got to charge your battery. So we drive. So you're looking at probably at least a 3 or 4 hour drive.
So yeah, we generally try and do three.
And you can't just start the engine and let it run for 4 hours.
You can.
Can you? I thought that was bad. You always told me that's bad.
You can potentially destroy your engine.
Yeah, it's bad. Don't do that.
You know, they're designed to run like that for 20 minutes to give you a top up, 30 minutes. You know, but engines are not designed to sit there. A, it'll overheat. B, it's just bad. It'll clog up. You say it's coking up. Essentially, it's not getting enough throughput through the engine.
So this is where people start saying, well, we'll put second batteries in. Because if they use one and that's taken 2 or 3 days, then they've got a second battery, leisure battery, that they can then spend another 2 or 3 days depleting before they have to top them both up. We find, because we tend to travel and wild camp, we don't stop in one place for days on end.
The other side to that is we try and make it so that if we are stationary for 24 hours, the next day we drive for at least 2 hours.
Yeah,
and that tops
that's what I meant. We keep topping up. And then also every 3 or 4 days we tend to use a campsite anyway, so we can use the facilities, empty waste and all the stuff, and then give everything a really good charge, because we tend to not leave our van and go exploring when we're wild camping, so we'll find a campsite, so we might as well plug in and charge everything up then anyway. Hey guys, I had to stop the video there and cut it into two parts because the internet where we're at in rural France is just atrocious and I cannot upload really long videos at the moment. So there's about another 20-25 minutes where we talk about solar panels and generators and inverters and how we've used all of those in our motorhomes to give us power whilst we're off grid. Now, this was a question that came up in our membership group where we answer questions and we chat live on Zoom to all the people who are in there. I'm going to put the second part of the video up imminently so the people who are in our group can see it first. If you want to be in the group and want to see it, you can join in. The link is in the notes below. If not, part two of this video will be out in a few weeks' time. In the meantime, things that are coming up on the channel, it's my birthday in a week and a bit. Whoop. And a couple of companies have offered some prizes to give away. It's just a bit of a fun thing for people who are on our email list. So if you currently get emails from me, awesome, you'll get an email very soon about the giveaways that are coming up. If you're not on our email list and you'd like to be involved, there's a link in the video notes. By all means, click that. I can send you a free road trip planner. You'll get checklists, there's guides, there's tips, there's all sorts of things about motorhome travel in the UK and Europe. And once you're on the list, you'll be emailed and telling you how to get involved in the prizes and the giveaways that we've got. Just as a quick whetting of your appetite, we've got Lifesaver giving away one of their amazing jerry cans that filters the water out. They're fantastic. So they've offered to give one of those away to one lucky winner. We've also got a sticker map, one of the ones that have showed the UK and Europe, so you can put the stickers of the countries that you've been to, which I know a lot of you asked where to get from, and they are like gold dust at the moment. So I've got one of them to give away, and I've got a couple of other prizes and things that I'm going to keep up my sleeve for the moment. But by all means, join our mailing list, and you will be notified about how to get involved. So those are the two quick things I wanted to talk to you about. One was our membership, and the other one was the email list. And I hope you enjoyed this video and found it useful. As I say, part two will be out in a few weeks, but you can see it quicker if you choose to. I hope you're all safe and well, and I will see you very soon. Take care. Bye-bye.
A good